Tonight we celebrate what Jesus has done. Tonight we celebrate the payment that Jesus made on our behalf, that we were sentenced to death. We did not qualify to be in his presence. Bible says that our righteousness was as filthy rags before him. Bible said there is none righteous, no, not one. So tonight we remember what Jesus did for us. It's not that we don't think about this every day. Every day you say, Jesus, forgive me. Every time you pray and say, Lord, forgive me, you are remembering today. But today we take it especially to acknowledge what Jesus has done on the cross for us. So as I encouraged earlier, I want you to keep that mindset. Keep your mind stayed on Jesus. Everything else can wait. In this moment, put yourself in the place of Jesus. Put yourself in the place of the cross. Put yourself in this time and in this season so that you can fully appreciate the weight of what Jesus has done for us. I want to encourage you briefly with Here I Stand. Let's go to Mark chapter 14. Mark chapter 14. The book of Mark, chapter 14, verse 53. Mark chapter 14, verse number 53. And Bible says, as they led Jesus away to the high priest, and with him were assembled all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes. But Peter followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard of the high priest. And he sat with the servants and warmed himself at the fire. Now the chief priests and all the council sought testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. Mark 15, verse 1. Mark 15, verse 1. Immediately in the morning, the chief priests with the elders, the scribes, and the whole council, and they bound Jesus, led him away, and delivered him to Pilate. Then Pilate asked him, are you the king of the Jews? And he answered and said, of many things, but he answered nothing. The story of Jesus Christ dying on the cross for us is a powerful story. It's a story of sacrifice. It's a story of brotherhood. It's a story of covenant. It's a story of commitment. That whilst we were yet sinners, Bible says Christ died for us. What God is impressing on me to share with you today is the weight that Jesus felt when he was brought before the councils. An innocent man being brought before the council, and they are doing everything to find an accusation against him, but cannot find any. They threw all the books at him. They did everything they could to find something that he had violated, and they could find nothing, to the point where the Bible says that they even had witnesses come and speak, but their stories could not match. Because it is a Jewish rule that on the testimony of two, a case shall be established. They could not find a testimony of two. He was brought before the high priest. He was a brief church history as we remember what Jesus has done. It was April 15:21. We are in April, right? 15:21, when Martin Luther stood before Emperor Charles to defend his teachings and writings. Martin Luther is known as the father of the Protestant movement because they protested what the Catholic Church was doing. That was where the Reformation started, and we get Protestants. He had just posted the 95 Theses on the door of the Castle Church in Wittenberg, Germany. 95 treaties of if this, then that, then this, and that. And the original intent was not an accusation. The original intent was to spark debate and discussion. He wasn't trying to say, I figured it out, take it. No, he was like, having done my study, like the way a professor will publish an article and his peers will look at it and write responses to his article. He was just, you know, saying, I've studied this and this is what I'm presenting to you. But the Catholic Church didn't like it. The 95 Theses challenged the authority of the church leaders and the idea that salvation was by works. Because the Pope at that time wanted to build some edifices. And because he needed money, he said, what is the best way but to place a tax on the people? So that every time they come, we will tell them that the soul of your loved one is stuck in purgatory. That is how purgatory started. Purgatory is the place between earth, it's somewhere between earth and heaven. And your beloved father, mother, brother, sister, family member might have done something wrong you don't know. So right now, he is being held in the jail in purgatory. And in order for you to get him out, you got to pay. You got to pay. And the steps were so high, with every step, oh Lord God, forgive Baba. I know Baba wasn't right. I know Baba didn't do right. Next step, oh Lord, please save Baba. Right, so you kept doing that. And if you got to the priest and he wasn't satisfied, you got to come back another day. Now, that is a mighty fundraiser. They did very well. If you look at the buildings in Italy, of the Vatican, yeah. Purgatory is not a thing. Purgatory is not biblical. It is appointed unto man once to die, after death, judgment. To be absent in the body is what? Is to be present with the Lord. And no purgatory in the middle. But this was what Martin Luther was challenging. That we are making people have to work in order to get to Jesus. Making them have to work in order to get saved. And he said that is not right. He proved through the scripture that salvation was not by works, it was by grace. Ephesians 1, by grace you have been saved through faith, not of your works, that anyone should boast. So with that understanding and that context, we see that Jesus Christ himself is being brought before a council to answer for his faith. To answer for his teachings. Now, he was crazy. I mean, Jesus was crazy. He says, before Abraham was, I am. I mean, he didn't even say before Abraham was, I was. He said, before Abraham was, I am. Present tense. And the Jews understood the power of I am. Because that was the name of God. And so he wasn't just using it in a sentence. He was making a point. That I am he. He said, tear down this temple, after many days I'll build it. Bible says he was referring to his body. But Jesus was confrontational. Jesus made a case for himself. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except by me. So Jesus challenged the Pharisees and the and the Sadducees, and he called them whitewashed sepulchres, whitewashed temples full of dead men's bones, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof. They wore the robe and the garments, and just like the Catholic Church did, there was an outward display of righteousness, but an inward void of the godliness of God. And Jesus came to confront that. He was accused, and he chose to die for you and me. I want you to leave here with this understanding. When Martin Luther was pressured to recant his teachings and his writings, they say, "No, bro, okay, if you're going to say that you did not mean to say, or what I really meant to say was, if you can begin with that, we're going to let you go. Like, just recant what you say, and we'll let you go." He responded with this, and I quote, "Unless I am convicted by scripture and plain reason, I do not accept the authority of popes and councils because they have contradicted each other. So unless you can convict me of scripture and plain reason, my conscience is captive to the word of God. I cannot and will not recant anything. For to go against conscience is neither right nor safe. Here I stand. I can do no other. So help me God. Amen." When he was pressured to recant his faith, he said, "I can't. I can't." When he was pressured to say that we earn our righteousness and we by works earn our righteousness, and the Pope is the one that decides the eternity of man, he said, I cannot by reason look at the scriptures and my conscience and all reasoning and say that's okay. He said, "Here I stand. I can do no other. So help me God." Good Friday today brings me before a cross, before Jesus died. Brings you before a cross, before Jesus died. And at that cross, you are supposed to be crucified on it. We are brought before a council of accusation and guilt and shame. But the most distressing thing is that I am guilty. God knows I'm guilty. The devil knows I'm guilty. I know I am guilty. That before Christ, the accusations that were brought before us and against us were true. We had sinned against God. We had violated his covenant. We had said one thing and done another. We had betrayed our covenants. We have kept from obeying the statutes of God. We have clearly violated his word. And so that cross before me was well deserved. Martin Luther did not deny that when he discussed grace. He acknowledged that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God, what? Is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. But in that moment, Jesus, having prayed and said, "Father, if it is possible, take this cup from me," took my cross and took my place. He came to that cross and he took my place. And the accusation against me was now against him. That you're a liar. True. You're a murderer. True. You are dishonest. True. You have violated the law of God. True. Every accusation of sin that was brought against us was brought against him. Bible said that the chastisement of our peace was upon him. The cost, the rebuke, the punishment that was deserving of my sin was upon him. Just a moment ago, I was taking the beating to get on that cross. But then he took my place and took the beating for me. Now the sound is different. I hear him say, I do not condemn you. Go and sin no more. So tonight we leave this place with this declaration, like Martin Luther, here I stand. Once I was lost, but now I am found. Here I stand. Once I was condemned, but now I am innocent. Here I stand. I deserve the punishment of God's anger. But here I stand, forgiven. That's what Good Friday is. Here I stand, forgiven. Here I stand, loved. Here I stand, accepted. Here I stand, belonging to the family of God. Don't forget that it is by grace. Believers, we do that too often. We are saved by grace. After that, we want to do everything by works. Saved by grace, but I got it, Jesus. When I need the Holy Ghost, just give me a little juice up and I got it. If you could not save yourself from death by works, what makes you think you can live this life by works? There are many things, if not all things, there are many things that we are doing in our own strength. Give it to Jesus. Give it to Jesus. It is not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. So today, you are forgiven. Today, you are loved. Today, you belong unto God. Today, you are His. Please stand up on your feet. Daddy, we give you praise. Daddy, we give you glory. Church, let me add this in encouragement. In the last days, and we are in the last days, we will be brought before the council of men to defend our faith. Bible says, be instant in season and out of season. Be ready to give a defense of that which you have believed. In the persecution, you'll be brought before councils. I encourage you and I charge you, stand like Jesus stood. Stand like Martin Luther stood and say, here I stand. I cannot deny my God. In the courts of public opinion, you will be accused. At the office, you will be accused. You know, I think, okay, I don't want to preach, but hear this, church. That many of us, our accusations that have been brought against us has been because of petty things. Shall we once for once stand accused for preaching the gospel? Shall we stand accused for being passionate for the things of God instead of things that do not matter? and he said and she said and he did, and unnecessary accusations. May you stand. When you are forced to recant, may you stand. When the enemy offers another option by God, may you declare, here I stand. I cannot deny, and I will not deny my God. Come on, lift your hands right now. I want you to pray with me right now. Whatever in the word encouragement touched your heart, I want you to just say, Lord, I believe and I receive it in the name of Jesus. Come on, open your mouth and talk to God. Open your mouth and talk to God. I am forgiven. I am the righteousness of God. I am forgiven. I'm the righteousness of God. I am forgiven. I am the righteousness of God. I am forgiven. Oh my God. Lete yele maluanda. Mayeke yele be remama mabosa tayalaba. The forgiveness of your sin came today. You see, the resurrection of Jesus Christ was to give you power by the Holy Spirit. But the payment of the sin happened tonight. You don't have to wait till Sunday to receive forgiveness. Forgiveness happened when the sacrifice was made. When the sacrifice was made, God's heart was made complete. God said, price paid in full. You don't have to wait till Sunday to celebrate your forgiveness. And the covenant was cut today. The covenant, the blood was shed for me today, and that I can come back home, that I can enter his presence with boldness, that I may receive grace and mercy in the time of need. Don't run away from God. Don't try to get yourself together before you come to God. And the veil was torn in two tonight, that we may be close to him. Would you take your communion elements? Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Sekai brando yolema, prepare your heart right now. You are forgiven. Every guilt on you right now is washed away. Every condemnation right now is washed away. There is no accusation against you. I don't care what they say. Jesus says that if you confess your sins, he's faithful and just to forgive you and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. So if there's anything in your heart, just say, Lord, forgive me. Lord, forgive me. Lord, forgive me. But we partake of this as a reminder of why I need Jesus. It is because of Good Friday. That's why I need Jesus. Because we tried the blood of sheep and goats and birds and all those, but that was not enough. But Good Friday was where I was able to say, God, I can come home now. In the night that he was betrayed, he took the bread, he lifted it up, he gave thanks, and then he broke it. Said, this is my body that is broken for you. Take and eat. The same manner he took the cup, lifted it up, said, this is the cup of the New Testament in my blood. As often as you do this, 2,000 years later, as often as you do this in remembrance of me. Take and drink. Don't live here with any guilt. Of all the days, don't live here with any guilt. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. In the book of Luke, chapter 23, Luke 23, verse 44, I'll just read it for you. Luke 23, verse 44. Luke 23:44. Bible says, and being in agony, he prayed more earnestly. Then his sweat became like great drops of blood falling down to the ground. When he arose up from prayer and had come to his disciples, he found them asleep. Am I reading the right one? No, I'm in 22. 23:44. Now it was the sixth hour, and there was darkness over all the earth until the ninth hour. Then the sun was darkened, and the veil of the temple was torn in two. And when Jesus had cried out with a loud voice, he said, Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. Having said this, he breathed his last. I want you to take your candle. I want you to turn it on. John chapter 8, verse 12. John chapter 8, verse number 12. Then Jesus spoke to them again, saying, I am the light of the world. He who follows me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. We have been commanded to be that light. Jesus in you, as you hold that candle in your hand, it is just as a reminder that you are the light of the world. No one lights a lamp and puts it under a bushel. No one lights it up and hides it. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. you praise. Thank you, O Lord Jesus. Thank you for the light of the Spirit of God. Bible said the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness could not comprehend it. I declare that the light of God in you cannot be stopped. The light of God in you cannot be held back. The light of God in you cannot be quenched in the name of Jesus. I declare that you will shine in this dark world. I declare that you will shine in this dark world. I declare you will shine in this dark world in the name of Jesus. You will shine in this dark world in the name of Jesus. No matter what comes against you, you will shine in this dark world in the name of Jesus. And the power of the Lord resides inside of you. Good Friday is God saying, my children are back home. My army is back home. And I'm empowering them with my Spirit that they will go forth and do great works in the name of Jesus. So, child of God, arise, shine, for your light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon you. You are the light of the world. In this darkness and in this dark age, you come with the power and the presence of God. Shine. Shine bright. Shine bright in all the power and in all the glory of God. That the name of Jesus may be lifted up in Jesus' name. Somebody say amen.